They had to believe, this was the test, that God's promise was trustworthy, or more to the point, that God is trustworthy. It's the same task we face from time to time, isn't it? Life suddenly gets difficult, and we're faced with a dilemma. Life feels like it's out of control. What are we going to do? Do we trust God that He will be with us still, that He will lead us, and that He will provide? Or do we go it alone and say, therefore, I don't think God knows what He's doing. I don't think God understands. I'm going to do what I need to do. If we don't trust God, our lives will go in one direction. So the first temptation Christ faced was to give in to His physical needs. And did you notice how the tempter started it? What word did he use to start the temptation? We're not going any further until you know. If. If you are, if you really are the Son of God. After 40 days of not eating, could you imagine how strong your willpower would be? And how clear your reasoning would be, or mine? Not that clear. And so the tempter is calling into question Jesus to question his own identity. If you really are you sure you're the Son of God? Do you really believe that? Do you really trust that God? I'll look after you. Don't sweat. And you see, you've got powers. If you doubt who you are, how do you have these powers? The argument can go. But you've got all these powers, you can just, you don't have to go to the grocery store. You can turn this rock into bread right now. Called into question his identity, who he is, the Son of God. And therefore, hold into question God's calling in his life and his purpose for his life. And the second temptation Luke records is the temptation to seek after something nobody ever tries to get, and that is personal power and glory. The devil took Christ to a high place and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and said, I will give you all this authority and all this splendor, it's mine. Didn't you know that? It's mine to give to whoever I want to, and I choose to give it to you if you worship me. If you bow down to me, I will give it all to you. There he is, calling into question again Jesus' identity and his purpose in his life by asking him to worship, to bow down to Satan. And Jesus responds, it's written, worship the Lord your God and serve only him. In other words, you're not to worship the devil. You're also not to worship your own selfish desires, especially for power and prestige and glory. In his answer, Jesus made reference again to Deuteronomy in the Old Testament, this time chapter 6, where Moses warned the people, the Hebrew peoples, about their attitude when they get to the promised land and they begin to prosper. The temptation is that after 40 years of wandering around in the wilderness and seeing day by day God's provision for them, his care of them, and their faith has been tested, and they're refined, and they get into the promised land, and everything goes great, and they start having great success in their crops and everything, then the temptation is for them to sit back with pride, Moses says, and pat themselves on the back and say, look at all that I have accomplished. Look at all of this. This is because of me. It's all because of me. It's all, therefore, it's all the two-year-old word. Mine! Mine! It's all mine. And then they forget, Moses said. And then you forget God. It's a call for us. You shall worship only God, and Him alone shall you serve. It's a call for us to remember that God is to be, and it sounds silly, number one in our lives. To have preeminence in our lives. Because you see, we live in a land of, and in a day and an age, as with every day and age, believe it or not, with so many conflicting gods, just as the ancient Hebrews did, just as the people of God did 2,000 years ago when Jesus was tempted in the wilderness. But when you say, wait a minute, we don't have lots of gods that are conflicting in our lives. Yeah, we do. Money, possessions, power, pride, position, status, everything. They may not be gods of clay and stone or fine jewelry, but they're still gods nonetheless that clamor to us for us to worship them. Any obsession in our lives that captures the lion's share of our time and attention has become an idol. A hobby or a sport can become idolatrous if it causes us to have less and less time for God, for living for God. Even our own family can become an idol. When we continually rationalize that missing worship is in the name of quality family time. When participating in the life of God's church in the world day by day, I can't do it because I'm so busy. God never intended us to be so busy that we don't have time for Him. Where is God in our lives on the scale of 1 to 10? 1 being the most important. Let's not kid ourselves, please. This is the season of Lent, the first Sunday in Lent in which we are to remember why Christ went to the cross and bring our confessions to God, knowing that He hears us and He forgives us already in Christ. Let's not kid ourselves. We live in a time and in a day and in a mindset in our culture of easy rationalization. So much that our devotion to God can easily become so watered down that we barely have time to give a nod to God's general direction. The drive for money and power and pride and position or a host of any other gods can pull us away from God's life. Satan's first temptation was for Christ to turn a stone into bread in order to feed his physical needs. The second temptation was the very human hunger for status, for power, for splendor. Jesus only needed to bow down to Satan in order to have everything that Satan promised him. If he would direct his worship to Satan, all would be great. Yeah, right. Jesus reminds us to direct our worship like he did, exclusively to God the Father. And the third temptation, to take the easy way out, to accomplish his mission, and thereby avoid the cross. After all, which one of us wants to carry a cross around with us? Oh, I don't mind carrying one around my neck. It's light, it's easy, I can easily forget that it's there. It doesn't cost me anything. Who really wants to walk to the cross? Why would Jesus want to do that and suffer the agony he knew was going to be there for him? Why? If there's an easier way out, then let's get on with it and let's see it. Satan took Jesus to the pinnacle of the temple. Oh, here it is again. If you are the Son of God, then throw yourself down from here, because it's written in God's word that he will command his angels concerning you, and they will guard you carefully. They will lift you up in their hands so that you won't even hurt your foot by striking it against a rock. Wouldn't that task have been phenomenal for Jesus' followers to see and for the crowd who's just starting his public ministry? What a way to start it with a bang. Throw yourself down from the highest point of the temple in Jerusalem, and everybody in Jerusalem will see the angels of God come and catch Jesus. And they will have no hard time whatsoever believing that Jesus is the Son of God. Satan quoted God's word, Psalm 91 that we read earlier. Satan is almost as good at quoting scripture as Jesus is, but always with a twist. Always with a twist of misdirection and misinterpretation. Jesus did not yield to the temptation to take the easy path. He knew who he was, a Lamb of God who comes to take away the sins of the world. He knew his purpose. He had come as the suffering servant, as Paul wrote about in Philippians in the New Testament. So to receive the acceptance and the accolades and the worship and the adoration of the crowds of people following him because of a false miracle, well, he wasn't going to go to the cross there if he took the easy way to get people to worship him. And that would completely ruin God's plan of redemption through the cross. And Jesus said, "Do not put the Lord your God to the test," God's word says. Moses referred to a time when people wondered if God was with them, just like from time to time, all of us wonder if God is still with us. If you don't believe that God is with you, it's really hard to not stand up to life's greatest challenges. Christ was not the first, nor the last, to be tempted to take a shortcut, to take the easy way, the less demanding way to achieve their goals. One of the greatest challenges that faced me as a student in high school and in university was to do what? It begins with C and then you get in a bit of heat. Cheat. To cheat. The easy way out. Rather than studying. Rather than doing the homework. Rather than writing the way you're supposed to write. Using your own mind. To cheat is the easy way out. If Jesus had done that, he would have cheated God. And he would have cheated all of us out of our life with him and our salvation. We're all tempted to avoid the hard work of being the best that God calls us to be in Christ. When the devil had finished all this tempting, Luke says, he left him until an opportune time. If we're successful in resisting one temptation, is Satan going to come back and tempt us again?
Yes.
Or say, "I can't tempt him anymore"? He's going to come back again. The opportune time, when do you think that was in the life of Jesus, that he would return to tempt him even more? The Garden of Gethsemane, when he felt the crushing weight of everything, the sins of the world would be right before him on the cross. So this is where we begin our Lenten pilgrimage, Christ being tempted or tested in the wilderness. Hebrews chapter 2, verse 18 in the New Testament explains why it was necessary for Christ to face these tests. Because he himself suffered when he was tempted, he is able to help those who are being tempted. And who are those? Every human being faces temptations. All of us are continually being tested and tempted. It might be a temptation as benign as Valentine's chocolates when I've given up chocolate for Lent. It might be as life-shattering as a temptation to take someone else's essay and hand it in school and then be discovered and charged with plagiarism and be kicked out of university. It might be as life-shattering as a temptation to steal money from your company. It might be as benign feeling as cheating on our income taxes, which, by the way, tax season is coming up. It may be temptation to laziness regarding our use of time, or to a more devastating temptation to use physical harm to hurt somebody out of anger. The message of Christ's test in the wilderness is that all temptation can be resisted. But how, you ask? How can it be resisted? I've already given you the answer. By making our primary allegiance, our number one, is Jesus Christ and serving him alone. It can be resisted by refusing to take the easy path, the easy way, and instead to seek to pursue the God-honoring way of living life. Unlike Jesus, we will never be in this world without sin. But with his help, and he promises he's with us, and he will help us every single time, we can resist temptations that are destructive to us and undermine our witness for Christ in the world. By his grace, we can grow stronger as we face the tests that come to us every day of our lives. Where will we be without Jesus in us? Thanks be to God.